Hello again and welcome back to our course on Access 2013. It's time now to get started on design and build of a database in detail, and we're going to start with tables. The main sample database we're going to use is a movies database. We won't get terribly far in the design and build of a movies database in the time of this course, but we should make a pretty good start, and I hope you'll get plenty of ideas to be able to carry it on later on and after the course is finished. Now, in terms of exercises for you to do, I will be setting these, and there is absolutely no reason why you shouldn't work on a completely different database yourself as we go along. Maybe something associated with your work, the job that you do, maybe something associated with an interest you have at home, and it's entirely up to you. The examples I'm using will mainly be around the movies database, although there will be one or two others from time to time. And if you follow along with what I'm doing, then you will find that you cover all of the main things that you need to know. One thing I should warn you about, though, before we start, is that in the early stages, this movies database is going to be pretty badly designed, as you'll see. I'm deliberately going to do a bad job for a while in order to illustrate what a good job is. So, let's get started. Okay, I've been working on a database here. I'm going to close it in the usual way, no changes. And I'm going to go for a new database. Now, in this case, I'm not going to use any of the existing templates. I'm going to go for blank desktop database. I'm going to give it a name, and I'm going to number these versions of this database as we go along, and that will tie in with some of the exercises that there are to do. So this is movies1.acdb, and I'm going to create it in that sample folder that I've used from time to time so far. So I'm going to put it in that folder with the contacts ones. And then I just click on Create, and my database is created. Now note that when it's created, the number of objects is very small. In fact, it opens a dummy table. One thing's for sure in an Access database, you're going to need a table. Now let's suppose that I just want to start getting some data into this table. Supposing I type in here the name of a movie. Here's a new movie. Press the tab key, and now let me put in the year of release, and let's suppose at the moment all I want to record is the name of the movie and the year of release. Now, you may recall from earlier on that in order to save a record to this database, or specifically into this table, I just need to go to the next one, the next record, the one that says new, and I've got a record in my database table. It says Identity Thief and it says 2013. But that's a pretty messy job, to be honest with you, because I haven't really looked at the structure, I haven't really looked at what Identity Thief and 2013 are, and so on. Now, you may recall that earlier on we talked about the different views of a table, and we're currently in Datasheet View, so we're looking at the data. What I want to do is to switch to Design View. Now, there are various ways of doing this. If you look at the buttons at the bottom right hand corner of the screen on the status bar, there are two buttons. The one on the left currently selected is Datasheet View. I can click on the one on the right, Design View. There's also a button on the left of the ribbon to switch views as well. But when I'm in Design View, I get a little bit more idea of the structure of my new table, although I can't see the data anymore at all in Design View. And what Access 2013 has done is to give me three fields. The first field ID I'll come back to in a moment. The second one, where I typed in Identity Thief, it's called Field 1. That's a default name. I'm going to change that name. I click in there and I'm going to change that to say Title. And of course, the third one should be Year of Release. Now, before I do that, let me just switch back into Datasheet View again. Note, whenever I've made changes, it says you must first save the table. So I'm going to save the table back in Datasheet View. I can actually click in the top, in the title here. And if I right click on there, I can say rename field. And I could put in there year of release. Now, my preference is not to put spaces in field names, but it is a preference. There are one or two technical reasons why it helps me a little bit not to have spaces. If you wanted to put year space of space release, that would work fine. Now, let's go back into design view. And as you can see, we can put those field names in either way. So we've got title and we've got year of release. Now, for each of these fields, when we entered the data to begin with, Access 2013 took a look at the data and tried to work out what the ideal data type would be. Now, in the case of title, it selected a data type of short text. And a data type of short text, if you look down at this grid at the bottom, means that there is a maximum field size of 255 characters. Now, I've no idea what the longest movie title in the world is, but 255 sounds about all right for me to cover the vast majority of movie titles. And to be fair, in many situations it's possible to change the data type and or the field size later anyway. But for the moment, I think 255 looks fine. Now, when it comes to year of release, Access 2013 has looked at the number that we typed in and decided, yes, this is definitely a number data type. And the type that it's put in is one that's called long integer. Now, long integer at the bottom covers very, very large numbers, and we wouldn't need them for a year of release. Given that in terms of the year, we're not far above 2000 now, it's going to be a long time before we need something that goes into the billions. So again, we could take the value that Access 2013 has suggested here, but we may want to review that later and in some way restrict it to being, for example, a year bigger than 1890, which is roughly when movies started, and probably less than, say, 2100, which will give us several years for our database to work in. But more of that later. For the moment, I'm going to stick with the title is short text and the year of release is number. Now, I'd like to go back to this first field again, this ID field, and talk about this because if you look at the ribbon at the design tab, note that it's a contextual tab under table tools that is there when I'm in design view on a table. You'll see that that's highlighted, and it's highlighted because the ID field is the primary key for this table. Now, when I create a table in Access 2013, under normal circumstances, it will always insert an ID field, and the ID field will have a data type of auto number, and it will be defined to be the primary key for this table. Now, there are quite a few important concepts in all of that. Let's start with primary key. Now, as a general rule, we need to be able to uniquely identify any record in a table. And in the case of our movie table, we need to be able to uniquely identify any movie. We must have one thing that says that is specifically that movie. Now, you may say, well, isn't the title a unique identifier for a movie? Well, let me give you an example. What about the movie True Grit that you may or may not have heard of? Now, True Grit is a 2010 movie, but in fact, it was a remake of a much earlier movie, a 1969 John Wayne movie. They both have exactly the same title, True Grit, so True Grit is not a unique identifier. You can't use the title of a movie as a unique identifier. In that particular case, there was also a TV movie made in 1978 called True Grit. Now, one option would be to combine together in some way the title and the year of release and say, well, if you put the two together, isn't that unique? Because in one case we would have True Grit 1969, then we would have another one, True Grit 1978, and another one, True Grit 2010. Well, that would probably work most of the time, and provided that nobody ever brings out a movie or a couple of movies with the same title in the same year, you'll be fine. When somebody does, there may be a problem. But in fact, the preferred method almost always is to use an independent identifier to uniquely identify a movie. And what we're doing in this case is saying this number, the number that is assigned automatically by Access 2013, is the unique identifier for this movie. Now, that doesn't mean to say that users have to know what this number is, or in fact that users ever see this number, but within our database system, the unique identifier is the one that we use to uniquely identify an object in the database. Now, that is the purpose of this first field, this ID field, and we will very often have an ID field for a table. Now, let's suppose that I did want to use the title and year of release to uniquely identify a record in a table. Now, it's actually very straightforward to do that, because all I have to do is to select the two fields. Using the mouse, I can just sweep over those two fields, and then if I click on the primary key button on the ribbon, they become together the primary key. They're not individually the primary key, they are only the primary key when used together. So you can easily change, but I don't want to do that. I'm going to go back to making the primary key just ID. The undo button comes in here, so if I change my mind, click on undo, and I'm back to just the ID on its own being the primary key, the unique identifier for a record in the table. Now I'd like you to see auto number at work, so I'm going to go back to datasheet view and enter some more data. Watch what happens when I switch back to datasheet view. As always, you must first save the table. Do you want to save the table now? Yes. Access knows that I've made changes, so I click on yes. Now then, let me go to new record, and the title of the new record is trying to be True Grit. Now, as soon as I start entering that next record, it is given an ID, a unique identifier. That number 3 will never be reassigned in this table again. 3 is unique, it will only ever be used once, it'll be completely unique. Press the tab key to go to the next field and enter there 1969, the year of release. Then I can click in title on the next new record, type that again, tab, put in the year, and so on. Now, if I make a mistake or delete one of these records or have to go back, Access 2013 will never reuse these numbers. So those numbers, those ID numbers, are always unique. That's an important point. And they're auto numbers, so you don't have to worry about putting the numbers in. Access 2013 does that for you. Now it's time for you to do some work on this database or on your equivalent. I'd like you to take what's in Movie 01, if you're following along doing this movie database, and basically what's in Movie 01 is what you can see here. I'd like you to add any other two movies. In fact, you can add more if you like, but you need to finish up with at least 5 movies. In each case, you'll need the year of release as well. And I'd also like you to create a second table. And the second table is going to be called Actor, and in that I would like first name and last name and year of birth. So straightforward enough, first name, last name, year of birth, and put in, say, 3 of the actors that appear in one or more of the 5 movies that you've added to the first table. Now, if you're a bit short of knowledge about movie titles and actors and so on, what you want is www.imdb.com, the Internet Movie Database. Thousands of films, thousands of actors, all the information you're going to need for this course. You can get it all from there. My answer to that is example 02 in the files provided with the course. And there's just one thing I need to mention before you start using the sample files for the course. When you open the sample files, with all or any of them, you may see a message like this, a security warning. Some active content has been disabled. Click for more details. I can assure you that the content for the course is safe. So when you see that message, you need to just click on Enable Content and it will go away. And later on in the course, when we look at security issues, you'll get an explanation of why that sort of thing appears. But for the moment, if you see that, click on Enable Content, all will be well. And I'll see you in the next section.